Imagine, it's December 24th, 2020. It's been 32 days since America's grid has collapsed. No one knows how long till they get the power flowing again. First, lone thugs and looters hit the streets looking to survive. They were soon swapped by roving bands of marauders, who were eventually replaced by well-organized and ruthless gangs. Big cities are now raging battlefields between rival gangs fighting over what little resources are left. 3 days ago, these thugs turned their attention to your area. Outgunned and outnumbered, you were forced to bug out and head for the wilderness. Now, what food and water you were able to take with you is almost gone. Hope of help reaching you has all but disappeared. Your entire family is looking to you to help them survive. There's fear in their eyes. You can see. You can feel it mixing in with your own. Could you look them in the eye and without a moment's hesitation say, "I got this"? Would you be able to provide food, water, and shelter to keep them alive? This may sound like a far-fetched scenario, but then again, even Congress knows our electrical grid is America's Achilles heel, and there's an avalanche of evidence that our electrical network is more vulnerable than commercial jets before 9/11. Plus, there are countless other scenarios beside a long-term national blackout that could lead to the exact same situation. That's why I want you to think about this. How would it change the game if you had a fully trained Green Beret with over 2 decades of real-life outdoor survival experience by your side at every moment to patiently offer you his entire attention and guidance, and dedicate every bit of his energy to ensuring your family is well taken care of, so you can rest assured knowing their safety and well-being are in good hands? What would it do to your confidence to have a Special Forces operator as your personal outdoor survival guide for when America descends into chaos and anarchy? My name is Bob. I've been an outdoor addict ever since I can remember. My childhood was all about getting as many Boy Scout merit badges as I could and building forts and tree houses and playing cowboys and Indians. Perhaps you remember the good old days. Even after I passed my Eagle Scout Board of Review, I'd sign up for whatever next level outdoor survival class I could get my hands on. And I pride myself as being better equipped to deal with real life survival situations than 99% of US citizens. That was until I decided to test 3 of the most important outdoor survival skills in a scenario much like the one I presented a few minutes ago. The skills were firecraft, shelter building, and water procurement. But there's a twist. To make things more interesting, retired Master Sergeant Brian Morris, a former member of the U.S. Special Forces, joined me. I met Brian at a wilderness survival conference. Now, I've been to plenty other conferences before, but up until I saw Brian's presentation, I never once felt like I learned something I haven't heard of before at least a dozen times. Something that, for once, seemed like next-level info. It felt like hearing declassified info that was only just being made available to everyday citizens. For once, I felt like Brian was someone who was willing to reveal the know-how everyone else wasn't, or perhaps that nobody else knew of. So at the end of one of his presentations, I introduced myself, thanked him for his presentation, and asked him if he'd like to join me for dinner, where I planned on digging even deeper, if possible. Well, I didn't exactly tell him about my secret agenda. I just told him buying dinner was my way of showing gratitude. Thankfully, Brian said yes. And over that dinner, I got to know more about Brian's history with the Special Forces. As it turns out, he's earned multiple decorations, such as the Bronze Medal, the Army Commendation Medal, the Joint Service Commendation Medal, just to name a few. And during the 2 decades he spent in the Special Forces, Brian fought in the most extreme environments, from the driest and hottest desert with the most infertile soil and fiercest sun, to snow and ice-covered mountains where temperatures rarely went above freezing. And that's not to mention hot, rainy, sweaty, muggy, and insect-infested hellholes. And although his name may not be well-known to regular civilians, inside elite military circles, people look up to him. And Brian Morris's name draws respect and admiration. So much so that he is currently one of those who helped train future Special Forces in the arts of bushcrafting and outdoor survival. The guy was practically a living legend, and I was having dinner with him. Plus, as it turned out, he lived a 2-hour drive away from me, which gave me the perfect opportunity to challenge his Special Forces survival methods to a clash between my civilian ones. I told him about my imagined scenario, stranded in the wilderness, no food nor water, with nothing but our knives and a few resources from our backpack. I told him I wanted to see for myself how someone with his background approaches the challenges of a survival situation. What methods would he resort to? Were they going to be different from the ones I already knew? As you're about to see, they were nothing like any I'd seen before. Plus, I found out for myself how some of the most advertised outdoor survival methods out there can easily turn into death traps. You'll see for yourself why right now. Brian gladly accepted my challenge, and 1 month after our dinner, we were in the woods tackling my imagined scenario. Our first order of business, shelter. We both needed to find a good spot to camp. When picking one, you need to consider your surroundings. Have you got lots of deadfall? Are you in an area that's sheltered in general? If you're out in an open field, there's not going to be much shelter. It's best to find those areas that are really dense and somehow naturally protected. We wandered around for a bit to see what we could find. Now, there had been a big storm in the area, and some trees had their roots blown over. Brian immediately saw this as an opportunity. The blown over root formed a natural wall, so we had almost half the shelter without having to raise a finger. And in a survival situation, you want to spare every single drop of energy you can. For the rest of the shelter structure, Brian went for a simple A-frame. I went out to look for a log in the ridgeline, while Brian started gathering moss and some smaller logs to make that A part of the actual shelter. Brian told me that the longer the log, the more room we would have inside. The general rule for one person is to find a log that's about 4 feet longer than the size of that person's body. Once we had our ridgeline, we carefully laid down the smaller branches onto each side. We insulated it by adding the moss, and it ended up looking like this. Now that we had shelter, we needed to start a fire. And this is where things got interesting. That's because we decided to get a contest going, see who could start one faster. And while I decided to muscle up and go for the hand drill method, Brian's approach revealed his special forces ingenuity, as he started a fire in less than 5 minutes by using his pee. Yes, you heard that right. Here's how he did it, and how you can do it too the next time you're out in the wilderness and need a quick way to start a fire. First, he collected his urine in a Ziploc plastic bag he had in his backpack. Then he found an opening in the tree line where the sun was shining all the time. Next, he took his urine-filled Ziploc, tightened it to form a little liquid pouch, and used it as a magnifying glass on some birch tree bark. And soon enough, he had a self-sustaining ember, to which he added some layers of grass and leaves, and he had a fire. Meanwhile, I was sweating bullets trying to rub one piece of wood onto another. I noticed Brian was shaking his head in amusement, which both annoyed and motivated me more. I was not going to give up that easy. I started spinning the drill faster and faster, but the sweat that fell off my forehead wiped out all my progress when it landed on the tiny ember that started to smoke. I was raging, especially compared to the little effort Brian needed for making his fire. I mean, this was not the first time I was starting a fire using this method. I knew it wasn't easy, but I knew I could rely on it if I had to. Now I was seriously starting to doubt myself. Not being able to get a fire going was a real blow to my morale. Looking back, however, I think it served me well. Maybe I was not as ready as I thought. And Brian knew exactly why. It wasn't my fault. I'd been lulled into a false sense of security by most of the books, courses, and survival shows I had devoured. How so? As Brian put it, it's not because the classes or the manuals or the experts had given me bad advice. It's simply because most of the things they teach are based on unrealistic expectations of the actual challenges one will face in a life and death scenario. Fire starting was the best example. Think about it. One of the most famous methods for getting a fire going without lighters or matches is the bow drill. In theory, it's simple. Rub two sticks together to create friction and generate heat. But if you ever tried it, then you know it's not easy, it's not quick, and it probably won't work if you're drained of energy. What Brian told me next stuck with me as one of the most important lessons of outdoor survival. He told me that in a real-life survival situation, you need to be able to think both inside and outside the box, and you can't afford to rely on just one solution. For instance, if there wasn't enough sunlight for his bag of pee method, he had at least three other fast alternatives for starting a fire. After the schooling I got in the art of firecraft, I was about to get one in water procurement too. We decided to go head-to-head here as well. Having the lesson of redundancy fresh in my mind, I decided to keep my options open and come up with a plan B. My first idea of water procurement was to dig a gypsy well. In layman's terms, it's a hole dug to collect water. But you can't just dig anywhere. Typically, you dig where you know the water table is just below ground level. I remembered that when looking for our camp spot, I saw a small plateau of peat which I noticed was particularly wet. I thought this was a good place to test my skill. I used my hands and knife to dig out a hole about 1 foot deep, and I was lucky enough to see the well starting to slowly fill up. Of course, the water needed filtering or boiling, but that was no problem. We had a fire going back at camp. If this wouldn't have worked, Plan B would have probably been a solar still. I was eager to brag to Brian about my accomplishment and to find out what he was up to. Imagine the look on my face when I saw him lying on his back, resting comfortably by the fire, doing absolutely nothing, and with no water in sight. I thought maybe he'd forgotten about this third challenge. He hadn't. He just saw an opportunity to get clean, fresh drinking water without raising as much as a finger. Here's what he'd done while I was out digging. He put some clean rags he had in his backpack on the moss roof of our shelter. He knew that as night fell, condensation would soak the rags, giving us enough water for the next day. Plus, it was 100% pure and ready to drink. No boiling or filtration needed. I could not help but feel that he would have absolutely no problem of making the wilderness his second home. The biggest difference I saw between Brian's skill and mine was this. I was more than competent, but everything I did required way more work, took more time, and drained more energy. Brian's methods were faultless and virtually effortless. And in life or death scenarios, the less time, energy, and effort you waste, the more you boost your chances of survival. And now more than ever, I felt like I was light years away from that. I felt like there were so many things I needed to learn, that Brian had so much to show me. Unfortunately, we were running short on time, so I only got to ask him about what sets Special Forces operators apart from everyone else. His answer was simple. It's the consequences. Unlike other survival experts who do what they do because they see it as a recreational activity and who risk absolutely nothing, Special Forces operators have everything on the line when they go on a mission. That's why they cannot afford for their methods to go wrong. They could get captured. They could put the entire task operation in jeopardy. They could embarrass their unit and their entire country. They could lose their lives and not see their families ever again. That's why their training is designed to show them how to adapt to all environments and scenarios, and exactly how to factor the inevitable fatigue and stress survival situations put you in. Their methods are definitely not one size fits all. Brian told me that his planning for outdoor survival focuses on an 8-pillar survival protocol that leaves absolutely nothing to chance. Those 8 pillars are shelter, the first and most important part of surviving the wilderness, and yet ignored by so many on account of being too complicated. Brian's shelter building methods focus on simplicity, which comes from being able to adapt to your surroundings and use what Mother Nature provided to your advantage. The second pillar is water. During a mission in an extremely arid environment where physical effort was intense, Brian's body lost almost 2 liters of water per hour. To keep up with this water loss, he had to sometimes drink up to 14 liters per day. That's why Brian was trained with redundancy in mind. To collect that much water, he needed to know how to tap in absolutely all the water sources around him. Next comes firecraft. Even though Brian highly advises anyone to carry a flint and steel kit or a ferro rod or several Bic lighters in their kit, he also knows that when modern fire starters fail, his primitive ones will pay off. That's why he knows more ways of starting a fire than he can count, and even how to improvise like he did in our adventure and start a fire in ways you never imagined possible. The fourth pillar is food. For a Special Forces operator to maintain efficiency during a mission, he needs at least 3,000 calories a day. To ensure that intake, Brian is an expert in snares, traps, tracking, fishing, and foraging. Security is the fifth pillar. It goes without saying that for a mission to be successful, Special Forces need to maintain their presence unknown. Brian's methods depend on several defense layers designed to keep him stealthy as a shadow in the dead of night. The sixth pillar is survival navigation. Due to the appearance of modern devices, less and less people truly give this the required attention. But what happens when GPS is dead, fog has rolled in, and you can't see more than a few feet in front of you? Will you know how to get back to camp or how to claw your way back to safety before nightfall? This is the kind of reason why Brian and Special Forces go the extra mile and leave nothing to chance. Then comes the seventh pillar, communication. Robust, reliable, and trusted communications are essential between members of a unit during a survival situation. That's why Special Forces have developed unique methods to help team members keep their actions in sync and their priorities aligned, especially when they cannot rely on radio signal. Finally, the eighth pillar is health. Brian knows every environment and landscape like the back of his hand, and he can transform his surroundings into his natural pharmacy to help him treat whatever injuries or sickness he must deal with. The more he talked, the more I was in awe of this man's wisdom. Having him alongside me in this imaginary disaster scenario felt like having an all-knowledgeable bushcraft and wilderness survival codex at my disposal. Unfortunately, our time together was coming to an end, and there was only so much I could learn from just one day spent together. And although Brian had showed me how to make a shelter, start a fire, and gather 100% fresh and clean drinking water with minimum effort and without using basically any tools or fancy equipment, these skills were only applicable to that one scenario and environment we were dealing with during that one day. I mean, what if it had been cloudy outside? How would his fire starting method be different then? And what if we hadn't found that blown up tree root? What then? That experience with Brian left me craving for more, and I just could not take my mind off Brian's eight-pillar protocol. I was like a junkie longing for more. So I did what every addict would do. I picked up the phone, dialed Brian's number, and asked for a second dose of a one-on-one wilderness survival lesson. Unfortunately, Brian was a busy man, juggling between conferences and special forces training. He barely had enough time to spend with his family. Even though I was disappointed, I understood. I realized there was no way I could go through all his eight pillars via one-on-one training. But that didn't mean there weren't other ways. So a couple of weeks after that, I called Brian again, except this time I had a different proposal for him. Instead of the two of us heading to the wilderness for a whole weekend time and time again, until we'd have all the eight pillars and all the possible climates and survival scenarios covered, he could instead put together a program based on those exact same eight pillars, where he would pour out all his knowledge, and he could do this from the comfort of his own home, and all while getting to enjoy more time with his loved ones. Even more, I told him I would pay for his time so that if he wanted, he could skip some of the conferences so he could spend more quality time at home instead of always being on the road. I told him that doing it this way, his work could help not only me, but all the American patriots concerned about the dangerous times we live in, who needed him by their side in case anything should ever go wrong. Plus, with this kind of know-how, America could restore some of the self-sufficiency we've lost over time. He told me he needed some time to think about it because what I was asking of him implied monumental work. And he also needed to check with his superior officers and ask them if it was okay to share his knowledge with the public. It wasn't until 1 month later that I heard back from Master Sergeant Brian Morris. He apologized for taking so long, but he needed time to cancel his conference seminars and to make sure that what he was going to reveal inside his eight-pillar protocol would not provide info that could harm his brothers on the battlefields. Now that he had a green light, he was ready to start work. I had just one more request from him: to keep the program straightforward, but don't cut any corners. It had to be simple and easy and user-friendly enough so that anyone with a will to survive could use it, even if they previously knew absolutely nothing about bushcrafting or wilderness survival. And it had to be thorough and comprehensive enough so that it would cover all possible climates and scenarios and not leave anything to chance, so that even those who have had some experience with outdoor survival could use it as their reference guide. However, he warned me, this was going to be a long process because it involved a lot more than knowledge outpour. It also meant Brian had to go outdoors and build every single shelter, every single trap, every single fire starting method he talks about in the program so that he could take pictures of it and include them in the final product. Over the next 9 months, Brian sent me bits and bits of his work, which I gorged upon, before carefully piecing them together one by one, pillar by pillar, until I finally had them all. The Ultimate Bushcrafting and Outdoor Survival Manual. Brian and I called it Spec Ops Bushcrafting, the Eight Pillars of Special Forces Wilderness Survival. And it's the only program I know of that offers passage into the unique action process of a Special Forces operator during a life and death survival scenario. Inside, you'll see how U.S. Special Forces stay alive in life-threatening outdoor survival scenarios using the eight-pillar system, all while maintaining operational security. With Brian's eight-pillar protocol by your side, you'll gain a sixth sense for adapting to any environment and scenario. So you can gain a natural instinct to come up with the best solutions to the worst conceivable problems and make life-saving split-second decisions in high-stress situations where time is of the essence and any mistake could be your last. You'll see how easy it can be to download the same Special Forces skills and knowledge into your subconscious, the ones that can ensure your survival in the outmost ruthless outdoor environment you can think of. And that will allow your family to outlast any crisis, be it a nuclear disaster, a grid-down scenario, or an economic or food crisis. You'll see how simple it can be for you to gain the same fluid, differentiated, and unconventional decision-making process of a Special Forces operator. Spec Ops Bushcrafting offers a step-by-step walkthrough of the counterintuitive, unconventional, and often dirty tricks and methods straight from those whose lives depended on them. Because while most bushcrafting books and courses out there are probably only useful for camping, harmless fun, and half-day hikes at most, the Spec Ops Bushcrafting opens a whole new dimension of survival intelligence, one that can help you once and for all achieve the peace of mind that comes with knowing that you can look in the eyes of those you care about most and tell them, without a shadow of a doubt, "I've got this." This program is made for those who know better than to rely on anyone but themselves when it comes to their loved ones' safety and protection, for those who endure and persevere in the face of adversity. But let's take a closer look and see what you'll get inside Spec Ops Bushcrafting. First, you'll discover the number one most determinant factor of outdoor survival, more important than fire, water, and shelter. It's the one skill that can ensure your survival in the outmost ruthless environment you can think of, even if you're left with little more than the clothes on your back. In fact, this one skill could also allow you to outlast any crisis, be it a nuclear disaster, an EMP scenario, or an economic or food crisis. You will get step-by-step walkthrough, the same kind that Special Forces trainees get, so you can develop the exact same skills in the shortest time possible and start experiencing mind-blowing benefits effective immediately. Next, you'll get a behind-the-curtains look at the fire-starting method, consistently rated more dependable than matches, lighters, or any flint and steel kit. This proved to be a lifesaver for more men than you can imagine. It was, until now, one of the closest guarded fire-making secrets of the military. With this, you'll have the possibility to master the one fire-starting method that works in pretty much all environments, instead of going through the hassle of cramming up a different method for each possible scenario. Furthermore, you'll discover 10 survival super shelters that will conquer the elements, and how to build them with minimum effort by carefully observing your surroundings and taking advantage of what Mother Nature put at your disposal, including the easiest shelter you should go for if you have a bad back. Once you get to know this, you'll gain a sixth sense for spotting the best camp locations and putting a shelter over your head with the least amount of effort. You'll get the Special Forces $1 DIY alternative to expensive modern-day water filters. Plus, what is perhaps one of the most advantageous, underrated, and currently forgotten skills practiced by our ancestral communities during their hunting trips. This will also help you maintain your OPSEC while traveling and not give away your location to the wrong people. Next, you'll come across the secret COLD system that breaks the code on how to keep yourself warm, dry, and comfy in extremely low temperatures. And you'll discover how even well-prepared adventurers trick themselves into a death trap by making this one simple gear mistake when dealing with intense or extremely cold weather. And with what you'll learn next, you'll never again worry about waking up in bone-chilling conditions, because you'll see how you can set your fire on autopilot so it will burn for 14, 16, or even 20 hours without requiring any attention and maintenance on your part, allowing you to focus on other tasks, such as setting up camp, getting some food in your belly, or just enjoying a good night's sleep. This is also extremely useful in grid-down scenarios. Plus, a little-known last-resort trick Special Forces know they can always count on for staying warm at night, even without a fire. Then, you'll discover a time-tested Green Beret hack to never get agonizingly painful blisters when traveling long distance, along with the Green Munch life-saving secret that cracks the code on how to easily identify edible plants and avoid over 712 varieties of deadly species. Plus, to ensure their calorie intake, Special Forces operators know they can rely on a 5-minute elementary process that paves the way for an almost fail-proof small game trapping session. You only need to go through it once for maximum results, and you'll almost never feel the frustration of having wasted your time and energy on another wild goose chase. And to help that, you'll also get a 1,000-year-old Native American sign-cutting and tracking method to help you locate the area with the most hunting potential. This is probably the most efficient tracking scheme out there, so potent that it has multiple uses, such as identifying if there's been a breach of the camp perimeter or running search and rescue missions. You'll find out about the unforeseen, yet most critical choice you need to get right before venturing out into the cold. That is, if you want to stand a chance of making it out alive. And why you'll need to make it twice, and for completely different reasons. You'll discover the Apache Rift Trap, a simple and super adaptable trap that can be used for catching almost anything, from big game animals such as deer, to smaller ones such as rabbits, foxes, or raccoons. Next, you'll soak up on how to find water in the most parched settings, so you don't have to waste precious energy on a pointless search. And you'll see why a person who packs a pair of a ridiculous item in their survival backpack increases his survival odds by 300%. You'll never guess what it is without the clues from page 23. Plus, did you know there's a blatantly obvious, yet almost never used hunting technique, ignored by so-called experts, on the account of it not being complicated enough? This hunting know-how is guaranteed to open up a completely new dimension, one where you will be able to pick up on the slightest wildlife movement that would usually go unnoticed by the human eye, so you'll dramatically increase your chances of having a delicious, all-natural, high-protein meal, even in the most brutal environments. And to go with this, you'll also get the Soldier's Quick Guide to Field Dressing an Animal, and why the single most common problem that causes meat to taste gamey or go bad is also the easiest to correct once you know what these guys know, plus how to preserve meat in the wilderness. Furthermore, you'll unravel the Jungle Core wet weather fire making technique, This is the exact same three-step process elite troops swear by to start a fire when all around them is soaking wet, so they restore some precious morale and get a good rest. This skill could prove a lifesaver if you ever get caught up in a storm and you need a quick way to get out of your clothes and get warm before hypothermia kicks in. With the 8-pillar protocol at your side, you will feel just as if Brian Morris himself were standing next to you at your personal disposal. Every time you will feel uncertain about a particular scenario or about what method you should resort to, it will be just like having your own Special Forces operator to guide you. Time and time again, he would patiently assist you in making the best possible choices. This will gradually help you develop a sixth sense for adapting to any environment and scenario. Until one day, when you'll suddenly start feeling more and more confident in your ability to adjust to any obstacle that may come your way. I really want you to experience the same thrill and excitement I got when I realized I was granted the unique opportunity of peeking inside the private world of Special Forces bushcrafting know-how. But you know what? It gets even better. That's because included in the Spec Ops bushcrafting package are three additional reports. The first report is the Green Berets Forager Handbook, a guide to identifying and preparing wild plants. This short catalog is a comprehensive index with colored pictures included of 25 of the top edible plants you're bound to run into, if you know where and how to look. And this report will make sure you will. Now, 25 plants certainly don't sound like a lot, but there's a good reason why more weren't included. First, memorizing what each of these 25 plants looks like can be a difficult task as it is. And second, Brian thought it was better to teach you how to fish instead of handing you the fish. That's why he also included a thorough description of the three totally independent tests you can resort to check if a plant is edible or not. These edibility tests are taken straight from the FM21-76 U.S. Special Forces Survival Course, so there's no way you can go wrong with them. Also included in this bonus is a simple 2-second scan guide to identifying poisonous mushrooms, and the one circumstance when you must absolutely avoid eating any kind of plants, even if they're edible, no matter how hungry and desperate you are. The second bonus comes as an extension to the first one and is called the Green Berets Field Guide to Nature's Pharmacy. As you know, Special Forces are prepared to handle any scenario, and with the high-risk situations they're always thrown into, injuries and sickness are bound to happen. It's often the case that survival in the wild comes down to preventing injuries from going from bad to worse. Luckily, antiseptics, anti-inflammatories, and coagulants thrive in nature. And a Special Forces veteran is like a walking natural treatments encyclopedia. Whether you'll need to craft a soothing lotion for your irritated skin, come up with a funny-looking tincture to fix a bad stomach, or harvest some pain relievers for later use, inside this guide, you'll discover how easy it can be to make your own outdoor remedies. Finally, for bonus number 3, Brian decided to do something to help forge the whole family into a functional unit, because they're the only ones you'll truly be able to rely on in case of a real-life crisis. And working together and helping each other will be the only way you'll be able to make it out of there. The best time to start forging that bond is now. But because sometimes it can be difficult to get others involved in your activities, Brian came up with 20 practical, simple, and fun outdoor DIY projects to help them build an appetite for bushcrafting. By now, you're probably wondering how you can get your hands on the Spec Ops bushcrafting, plus the extra reports that come included: the Green Berets Forager Handbook, the Green Berets Field Guide to Nature's Pharmacy, and Family Bushcraft. Let me start by assuring you that the price, compared to what you're getting inside, is a bargain. I mean, people like you and me get to hone their skills like America's elite soldiers. That's a privilege by itself, and something for which, up until now, you would have had to pay a lot more than money. Learning these skills cost brave men's youth. It cost them years away from their families. It cost them colossal pain, both mental and physical. You and me, we're lucky. We can get away with spending a few bucks and getting these skills on a silver platter. Think about it. How many of the people you know get to say that they're a part of the enclosed circle with access to leading-edge knowledge, skills, and abilities needed to withstand and outlast any scenario? Once you enroll in the Spec Ops bushcrafting training, you'll be one. Look, getting one-on-one training with someone with Special Forces background would cost you thousands of dollars. A one-week survival camp would run you dry of at least $1,000. Even two-day courses are nowadays priced around $300 to $400. And those only cover just one particular subject of wilderness survival. After all, there's only so much you can cram up in a two-day camp. Leaving bushcrafting classes aside, I've been guilty of spending money on useless stuff too. I'm talking about fancy gear with names that don't mean anything. Ultralight, Versatrack, Flex Boil technology with fully integrated switch lock packaging. I've dropped loads of cash on that, only to realize that the best investment you can make when it comes to surviving in the wilderness is not in equipment, but in yourself. in gaining the skills and the knowledge that will get you through. And the good part is, in this case, the knowledge you can get inside the SpecOps bushcrafting program comes a lot cheaper than most of the useless gizmos on the market. For instance, this hiking GPS goes for over $150. What good will it do when it loses signal or when it runs out of battery? A real outdoorsman doesn't need any fancy apps to help him find his way around. So rest assured, the SpecOps bushcrafting program won't cost even half of what that GPS would. In fact, it's even less than a decent bushcraft knife I got for my kids. That means you can get your copy of the SpecOps Bushcrafting, the 8 Pillars of Special Forces Wilderness Survival, plus the Green Berets Forager Handbook, a guide to identifying and preparing wild plants, the Green Berets Field Guide to Nature's Pharmacy, and Family Bushcraft, 20 fun DIY outdoor projects for getting your family involved, for the price shown on the button below. Just click on the cart button and get started on your Special Forces bushcrafting and outdoor survival journey. Think about this for a second. How many hundreds or thousands of dollars have you wasted over the years because you got so caught up in the gear and bought items to help you outlast any crisis? When you compare that to the measly price you'd have to pay for the proven bushcrafting skills and creativity of the Special Forces, you'll realize that the investment you're making today is a drop in the ocean. Remember, you'll be getting knowledge you can count on, not just for staying alive in the wilderness, but for making sure your loved ones are well taken care of, for making them trust your ability to keep them safe and provide for them no matter what. And most importantly for you, never having to experience the consequences of a real-life survival situation. And one last thing I forgot to tell you. If you act now, you can still be one who also gets to benefit from the Premium Support Membership. Because no matter how hard Brian Morris worked to make sure SpecOps Bushcrafting was the most complete survival guide out there, there will always be questions. That's why, alongside the program and the 3 bonuses, we're also getting a direct email link with Brian's support team. That way, when questions arise, or if you think something is unclear, you can just send an email, and in the shortest time possible, you'll get the extra information and guidance you need. All you have to do, if you want to learn from the best, is hit the button below. Now, if you're still on the edge about whether you should try this, it's only natural. Let's face it, in this day and age, it's better to take every claim with a grain of salt. If I were in your shoes, I wouldn't want to jump the gun either. That's why, to show you how much Brian believes in his program, he decided to remove any financial risk on your behalf. Here's what I mean by that. Every purchase of SpecOps Bushcrafting is backed up by Brian's Military Code of Honor Guarantee. To put it bluntly, you can try out the crash course for 60 days without virtually having to pay a single cent. How does that work? It's simple. You sign up for the program now by clicking the button below. You get your copy of the SpecOps Bushcrafting. You get your 3 bonuses, the Green Berets Forager Handbook, the Green Berets Field Guide to Nature's Pharmacy, and Family Bushcraft. And you take the next 60 days to put the program to the test. Just like every soldier has to go through Hell Week before getting the honor to be part of the Special Forces, you get to put the manual through 2 hell months before you decide if it's worthy of its name or not. Do anything you want with it. If at any time during this 60 days period, you realize it's not everything you hoped it would be, all you'll have to do is to send an email asking for a refund, and you'll get your money back in less than 24 hours. You don't even need to give an explanation, and no one will ask you why you chose to do that. The way I see it, it's simple. There is nothing for you to lose by trying out SpecOps Bushcrafting, and everything to gain, like the perhaps once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to peek inside the private world of Special Forces Bushcrafting training methodology. You either liked it, or you don't pay. However, I think you'll congratulate yourself daily for making the right choice and trying it out. So what are you waiting for? The best things in life happen when you least expect them. Click the button below, claim your 60-day Military Code of Honor Guarantee, and give the SpecOps Bushcrafting program a chance. Don't pass up on this offer and let this opportunity get lost. If there ever comes a time when you or your family's life is at risk, these time-tested and proven skills will be your safety net. My guess is you never experienced an outdoor situation where you were forced to find something to eat or risk falling victim to starvation, or one where if you couldn't get a fire going, you would freeze to death. Not a lot of us have, but Special Forces all around the world go through this day in and day out. That's why they're the best instructors for this. You wouldn't want to learn from someone who's barely slept a night outdoors without shelter above his head and food in his belly. Just like you wouldn't want someone who's read a manual of medicine perform open-heart surgery on you instead of a doctor with 25 years of experience. And you won't find this information anywhere else. Just click on the button below and get started right now. Don't take the deceptive calmness of your everyday life for granted. All that could change in a moment. You never know what tomorrow has in store. We live in a fragile society. We can see the world changing. And with that change, there is always a danger around the corner to challenge our survival instinct. Now, I don't know about you, but I can't be caught with my pants down when my family needs me the most. And if you're not ready to step up when push comes to shove, the consequences could be tragical. You now have the opportunity and the power to set up a safety net for you and your loved ones in case things ever go south. What if tomorrow, next month, or even next year, you're forced to leave your home at a moment's notice and survive in the wilderness for God knows how long? Wouldn't you want to sleep soundly at night, knowing that you're prepared to turn the outdoors into your new home? Wouldn't you want to enjoy the confidence and security that comes from knowing that you possess all the skills required to exist and thrive in the wilderness? And that you're not gambling your family's well-being on the hope that nothing bad will happen? Sure, chances are slim, but I was raised in the spirit of hoping for the best while preparing for the worst. If those words resonate with you, just click the link below and get your Spec Ops Bushcrafting program right now. Think of it this way. If you met someone with a 20-year background in the Special Forces and he'd tell you he could improve your bushcrafting skills up to the point where you could survive outdoors with minimum equipment and that he'd do it for free if you're not happy with what he showed you, would you let him? This is the exact decision you must make right now. There are two outcomes to it. The first one, you get the results you were hoping for. The second one, you're not happy with what you got and you get a full refund. You come out smelling like a rose no matter what. Ball is in your court. All you have to do is click the button below and let the Special Forces methods do the rest. And soon enough, you're going to feel like a kid on Christmas morning, buzzing with excitement over the new insights and possibilities that are going to unravel in front of you.